اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. اللهم اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي.
الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره ونستعين به سبحانه وتعالى ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ به جل وعلا من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. عباد الله، أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله، وأحثكم وإياها على طاعته، وأحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولا شيء مثله، ولا شيء قبله، قديم بلا ابتداء، دائم بلا انتهاء، لا يفنى ولا يبيد، ولا يكون إلا ما يريد، لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام، ولا يشبه الأنام، حي لا يموت، قيوم لا ينام، سبحانه لا مثل له ولا مثال له ولا مثيل له ولا مماثل له، ذلك بأن ربنا جل وعلا موصوف بصفات الوحدانية، منعوت بنعوت الفردانية، ليس في معناه أحد من البرية. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا ونبينا وشفيعنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك وجدد وعظم وضاعف ومجد على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين، سادة الأنام وحماة بيضة الإسلام، موضحي حقائق الدين وقاهري أحزاب المفسدين، وسهام من مرام الله على المنافقين، ورضي الله تبارك وتعالى عن صحابته الغر الميامين، نخص منهم ساداتنا أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، وعن سائر الصحابة والأهل والقرابة ومن اتبعهم بإحسان وتمسك بالثقلين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، عباد الله، يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في المحكم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ولقد سبقت كلمتنا لعبادنا المرسلين إنهم لهم المنصورون وإن جندنا لهم الغالبون. The meaning of the ayah, or the couple of ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, وَلَقَدْ سَبَقَتْ كَلِمَتُنَا. Our will, Allah's will جل جلاله, Allah is talking about himself subhanahu wa ta'ala, our will has been already ordained and done, executed. Because Allah's will anyway is eternal, everlasting, not subject to change, not similar to the creation. Our will, kalima, is his will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's say his command has been executed. وَلَقَدْ سَبَقَتْ كَلِمَتُنَا. To who? To al-mursaleen, the prophets and the messengers. What is the will, what is the command, what is the order that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them, and it's already executed, not negotiable? إِنَّهُمْ لَهُمُ الْمَنْصُورُونَ. They are indeed the victorious ones. وَإِنَّهُمْ لَهُمُ الْمَنْصُرُونَ. They are actually the victorious ones. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then continues in the next ayah to telling us that they are actually more than just victorious. الغالبون. They will overcome everybody else. The reason sometimes when we stay away from Al-Qur'an Al-Kareem, this is one of these treasures of the Qur'an, this ayah. And all the Qur'an is treasures. But this ayah is beautiful. And it shows you Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way in this universe. See, we are limited by what we know. A human being is limited by what they know. You make judgments based on how much knowledge you have. In business, you make judgment based on the business knowledge you have. In your life, you make a judgment based on the knowledge you have. But the fact is that we are limited by what we know. So what we know limits our decision-making capacities. The point here is, not only are we limited by what we know, but what we know is limited. No matter how much you know, there's still someone who knows more. And therefore, your decision is always incomplete in a sense, relatively speaking. A human being, when they look at things and they compare things, what do they do? This is what they're talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what they're saying. Muslims are humiliated. Islam is never humiliated. Islam can never be humiliated. Period. That it's the deen of Allah subhanahu wa taala. Wal Habib al A'zam sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, nobody can humiliate him. You can say whatever you want about the sun, but the sun is always shining. Can you stop the sun from shining? The point is, sometimes people always consider things from a very narrow point of view and from a very narrow perspective, and therefore they issue judgments. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala في القرآن الكريم wants to tell those who believe in Allah on the Day of Judgment, those who believe in justice, those who believe in freedom by being enslaved to Allah, not freedom by being enslaved to the slaves of Allah. Different. Telling all of them that as long as you are among those al-mursaleen, or those who follow the mursaleen, the prophets, then you will overcome and you will prevail and you will be victorious. What is needed then? Since we know this as an introduction, we know that the ibad of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are victorious. The messengers of Allah will overcome. A message of justice and freedom and haqq versus batil will always prevail. Then what is needed? Two things. The ulama always mention two things. Patience on what? Sabr. Sabr means patience. On two things. As-sabru ala ta'atillah was-sabru an ma'siyatillah. That you have patience on obeying Allah. The obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The obedience of the Creator. Do we have patience on the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And patience, the other kind, patience from disobeying Allah. Notice, patience obeying Allah and patience from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If these two factors are there, then one is following the pathway of the prophets and the pathway of al-mursaleen and the pathway of al-awliya wa salihin. What do we mean by being patient on worshipping Allah? Things happen. You think that people now started talking or writing bad things about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Is this the first time? When did it stop? To start with, this is the question. Has it ever stopped? Have people ever stopped talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a bad way? No. Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Abu Sufyan at the beginning, all these people, there's a line that's continuing. Nothing has changed. Faces have changed, names have changed. But the situation is pretty much constant and it's pretty much relative, isn't it? Places have changed, but the game is the same. Okay. But what is the response? What do we do about representing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Have we revived a sunnah that people killed? That we have killed? Listen up, people. Let's talk about ourselves. Have we revived a sunnah that we killed in our homes? Have we revived the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we have killed in our children? Have we revived a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we have killed in dealing with our society and people and Jews and Christians and alike and everybody else, with the trees, with the environment? Have we revived the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Supporting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not in need of our support, number one. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him as the best of the creation. But what is needed here is this, the reviving of these values and these principles that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with in our lives. What is this going to do to us? Are we going to hold now every day a 5 minute, I'm not saying 50 minute, a 5 minute session with our children, talking to them only about one hadith every day at our homes? Open up Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih al-Muslim. Say, okay, here's one hadith about our most beloved sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Are we implanting these values? Because lip service is easy. Everybody can, oh sure, we denounce, we do all these things. But let's be more practical. What comes after denouncing all these things? Are we going to actually change or not? This is what determines really success or failure. Is our dealing with our fellow brothers going to be better? Or is it going to be the same? Are we going to go out of the masjid talking about this and that? Biting this and that? Are we going to be cheating this and that? Are we going to disregard our fellow brothers and sisters? Are we going to disregard humans regardless of what faith they belong to? Doesn't matter. Islam respects people. We respect their humanity. Fine. The values that must be implemented. And of course, when these values are not revived and we do not relive them again in our lives, what will happen is a state of hopelessness. And you see that. Hopelessness, total hopelessness. Why? Because there's a discord, there's a disconnection between the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the values he embodied, and then what people nowadays, what we do as Muslims. And until this connection is connected again and is not severed, then we will suffer these things. In the midst, and let me just go through the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to show you, in the midst of the most difficult time, how did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam react? Hadith al-Sahih. It's an authentic hadith. Khabbab radiallahu anhu. Khabbab ibn Arat radiallahu anhu is among the very early Sahaba. Early ones, those who mastered everything really. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa allahum. Khabbab, in the middle of da'wah, we're in the Makki period now. We're in Mecca, not yet to Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has only few people around him. Usually the poor, the needy, the slaves, the weak. Those are the people that believed in him, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Khabbab was one of them. And Khabbab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting. Still, this is the Makki period. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announced his da'wah and the people are against him. Everybody's against him. The whole world was against him. Him and few people. Khabbab comes to him with his face covered with blood, bleeding like you can't even tell who it is. And he runs to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Said, Ya Rasulullah, ala tastansiru lana? And his voice is crying, blood is coming out. Ya Rasulullah, oh Rasulullah, don't you make dua for us? Don't you ask Allah victory for us? Look at it. Blood, all these things. They're torturing me just because of La ilaha illallah. Ala tad'u lana? Ala tastansiru lana? The narrator of the hadith says the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat up. And he looked at him. He said, Ya Khabbab. Listen to these words from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Ya Khabbab. لقد كان يؤتى بالرجل في من قبلكم. Before you, in the times before, they used to bring the man. فيحفر له حفرة في الأرض. Then they would dig a hole for him in the ground. فيوضع فيها. And they will put him in this hole. ثم يؤتى بالمنشار. Then they will bring the chainsaw. فيوضع على رأسه. They will put the chainsaw right in the middle of his head. فيشق نصفين. They will split him into half. ثم يؤتى بأمشاط الحديد. Then they will bring the combs of iron, of steel. فيمشط بين لحمه وعظمه. They will separate his skin from his bones. على أن يكفر. So that he disbelieve. فما يصده ذلك عن دينه شيئا. That will not change him from his belief. يا خباب. Still the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is telling him. يا خباب. أو خباب. والذي نفس محمد بيده. By he who created the soul of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. ليتممن الله هذا الأمر. This deen will be perfected. This deen will prevail. حتى يمشي الراكب. Until the man will walk from صنعاء to حضرموت لا يخشى إلا الله والذئب على غنمه. Until the man who will walk from صنعاء to حضرموت does not fear anything but Allah and the wolf eating his sheep. ولكنكم تستعجلون. But you rush things. But you rush things. The last words. ولكنكم تستعجلون. But you rush things. You want it now. When do you want? Yesterday. Without doing anything. In the midst of, let's try to take a little step away from the hadith. Take a look at the hadith. In the midst of torture. As-Sahaba radiallahu anhum are being tortured for believing in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are being killed. They are being persecuted. Their properties are being confiscated. Their families are being slaughtered. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sits in right in the middle and looks at him as if he is looking at the unforeseen in front of him and telling him, Ya Khabbab, this deen will be perfected. But you just rush things. Look at this trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this vision. Of course, for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's not vision; it's wahi. For us, maybe. But look at that. Passes by few people. Same still in the Makki period, where humiliation was there for anyone who believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He passed through people; they start cussing him and cursing him. This is the weapon of the weak. Yani the weak. The weak, when they can't fight you with proofs, how do they fight you? By cursing you. By spreading rumors about you. And that's the only way they can fight you. Otherwise, if they come face to face, they have nothing. But when they spread rumors, it's easy. Silah al-da'if then. This is the weapon of the weak. It is the weapon of the inarticulate. Normal. He comes, passes by them, they look at him, they curse him, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Wa huwa ashrafu khalqillah. He is the best of the creation, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi wa alayhi. He doesn't say anything. They curse him, he doesn't say anything. He keeps walking. They curse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He comes back to them. They started laughing. He says, you are laughing? You will be laughing little and crying a lot. Indeed, they laughed little and cried more. Notice? In the midst of things. In the midst of the torture. Bye. Another scene. Still in the Makki period where the Muslims were very few and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not have control of Mecca or anything. And just the announcement of the da'wah. Uthman ibn Abi Talha al-Shaybi al-Abdari, he used to have the key of the Kaaba. Until today, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept it in their own family. And until now, Bani Shaybah, if you go to Mecca, the key of Kaaba is in the hands of the descendant of Bani Shaybah. Until the day of judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, you keep the key of Kaaba with you. No problem. Fine. This man was kafir, Uthman ibn Abi Talha. Uthman ibn Abi Talha, one day, it was an honor, not every day the Kaaba door opens. So the people of Quraysh, the leaders of Quraysh called this man, Uthman ibn Abi Talha, told them, Ya Uthman, please open the door for us so we can get honored by entering the Kaaba. People in Mecca heard that the door of Kaaba is opened, people lined up, everybody lined up to enter the Kaaba to get the blessing of this place. Still in the time of Kufr. Who came and lined also in the line? Al-Habib al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. They came in the line. They opened the door for the people of Mecca. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lined up also to go into the Kaaba. Also to have, with the rest of the people. They don't accredit him as a, they don't recognize him as a prophet. They don't, they're fighting him, but he's from Quraysh, from Bani Hashim. He's a resident of Mecca. And Uthman Nabi Talha, he lets everyone by one go into the Kaaba, pray, do whatever you want, come out. And then the next one, and he has the key standing at the door. Until the door, the line goes one after one, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam patiently waits until the line comes to him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Uthman bin Talha looks at him, says, "You?" Huh? He locked the door of the Kaaba, closed the door, said, "No more. Here's the key. Why don't you open?" He said, "No more. Today we have no more visitation to the Kaaba." Huh? Took the key, put it in his pocket, hide the key. There's no more. Huh? Why? What did I do to you? Nothing. Doesn't matter. Like some people like that. Well, they just hate you. Subhanallah. Some people are born. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Some people are like that. Some people are like that. They're hateful for being born. Whatever you want to call it. But this man changed. Allah changed him. Anyway. Uthman ibn Talha puts the key, it was hurtful to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. "I did not do anything to you." He looked at him, but he smiled. Look at this. And the people are all sitting around watching. What is going to happen? What is he going to do? Muhammad has no power, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is he going to do? Uthman ibn Talha, Bani Shayba, he has the key, he has all these things, he's in charge. People are with him. What are you going to do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at him and smiled. Childish. That's what it is. He said, "Kayfa bika ya Uthman?" Ya Uthman. Now he's talking to him. Very soft voice. Very nice. He said, "How about you, ya Uthman? What if? What if? Let's think. Kayfa bika ya Uthman?" Look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. "Kayfa bika ya Uthman? Idha asbaha hada al-miftah fi yadi." If this key that you hide in your pocket becomes in my own hand, I let whoever I want into the Kaaba, and I prevent whoever I want from going into the Kaaba. And people say, "What is wrong with you?" You're gonna. Uthman ibn Talha said, "Idhan dhallat Quraysh wa hanat." He tells them, he said, "Then Quraysh, if that would happen, you and you will the key of the Kaaba will come to you." If that ever happens, and that's not even a point, but if that happens, hypothetically speaking, then Quraysh would be humiliated indeed. It's the humiliation of Quraysh. And Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Bal azzat Quraysh wa sadat." But indeed, Quraysh will be honored and will be glorious when that happens. What happened? The Muslims come into opening Mecca, and the key is still the armies of Muslims. After years now, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam leaves, migrates to Medina, and then the army of Muslims come and they take Mecca, they enter Mecca. What happened? Uthman ibn Talha still has the key. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam sends Ali ibn Abi Talib, says, "Ya Ali, go and take the key from Uthman. Tell him we want to open." Don't take the key. Tell him open the door for the Muslims to purify the Kaaba, clean the Kaaba. And let Ali ibn Abi Talib, go at that time 20 some years old. He goes, Mudajjaj bil silah, he's filled with armor. Sayyidina Ali was a soldier, as you all know. He goes to Uthman ibn Abi Talha. Salaamu alaykum, alaykum salam. He says, "Inna Rasulullah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam orders you to give me the key or to open the door." He says, if I recognized him as Rasulullah, I would have given him the key myself. I would not give him the key to the Kaaba. This is the key that I have from my family. Sayyidina Ali heard him saying this, took his hand, twisted his hand, took the key away from him. "You don't want to give it like this? Okay, I'll take it from you another way." Took the key, went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and opened the door of the Kaaba to the Muslims coming one after one. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka, labbaik. An ayah is revealed. Inna Allah ya'murukum an tu'addu al-amanat ila ahliha وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَنْ تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. An ayah is revealed, the meaning of the ayah. Allah orders you that if you take trust from people, you give it back to them.
What does this mean?
Ya Ali,
Ali comes,
says, take the key, give it back to Uthman ibn Abi Talha.
Ya Rasulullah, just give it back.
What ayah came? This. Sayyidina Ali goes again to Uthman ibn Talha, knocks the door. He says, Ya Uthman, here is the key. Uthman is still kafir at that time, Uthman ibn Talha. He says, Ajibtu laka ibn Abi Talib. You amaze me, ibn Abi Talib. And one time, I don't give you the key. You twist my hand, almost breaking my hand. You take the key against my will. Now you come with your own free will and give it to me. What is this? He said, it's not me. And it's not me. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed on his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we should return the trust to its people. Uthman ibn Talha said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. In the midst of things, look how things turn. In the Hijrah, and the Hijrah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes with, goes, leaves the, Mecca with Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda, and they are right in the middle there with their dalil, Abdullah ibn Surayqib, their dalil, the one, the guide through the desert, and Suraqa ibn Malik, one of the people. Of course, Quraysh, when they heard, when they realized the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left Mecca, what did they do? They hired all the experts, trace experts, desert trace experts. You find the trace anywhere you want. They let everybody go, big reward, all these things, whatever, millions, just go get them. Everybody went in different directions. Suraqa ibn Malik is the one that got close. He realized, the expert in the sand, expert in all these things, expert in the movement, he figured, okay, this is the way. He went. And indeed, he was a sight away from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was getting soon closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu says, Ya Rasulullah, he's right behind us almost. And Nabi Al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wasallam looked at him and he said, Allahumma ruddahu anna. Oh Allah, prevent him from coming to us. The narrators of the Sirah al-Masira says, the minute the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said this, these words, Jibreel came down and stood right in front of the horse of Suraqa ibn Malik. And the horse starts sinking in the sand. Well, go front, you can't go. Jibreel in front of you. Back, yes. In front, no. Suraqa was almost one spear away from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He realized something wrong. What is this? I'm trying to follow him. He said, I can't do this. Moves again, can't. Moves back, yes. Moves forward, can't. Subhanallah. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at Suraqa. Hey, you trying? I'm Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who are you trying to? What are you trying to do? He then told him, Taktimu anna ya Suraqa. Walaka min aswari, min sawari Kisra wa Qaisar. If you just go back, go home. Go home and I promise to give you from the private jewelry of Kisra, the king of Persia, and Qaisar, the king of Rome.
No, wait a minute. You are escaping, you're a refugee right now in the desert, you have absolutely nothing to your name. From their perspective. And the kingdom of Persia is one of the biggest kingdom on earth, and the next to the kingdom of Rome. You're telling me, now, in this city, you're going to give me from private jewelry of Kisra and Qaisar? نعم أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله.
الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر. أشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله خاتم الأنبياء المعتبر صلى الله وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي وعلى آله أهل الفقه والنظر والعلم والأثر وعلى من بآثاره مقتفى واعتبر. He said, Ya Suraqa, go back. You go back and you have a promise from me. Suraqa, the Sirah scholars, they wrote, they said, let me have that in writing. Not that he said, you know, maybe I can't get to him, so there's got to be something. Maybe anyway, let me give me that, write that to me. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Abu Bakr, write. Right, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wrote. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised Suraqah bin Malik that he will get from the private jewelry of Kisra and Qaisar.
Yeah, okay, good. Assalamu alaikum.
Days come and years go, and in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Umar says, where is Suraqah bin Malik when now the kingdom of Persia and the kingdom of Rome was, the private jewelry was in Bayt Mal al-Muslimin. Where is Suraqah bin Malik? Come here, ya Suraqah. Where is the paper that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave you? Here is the paper. Here is what he promised you. Huh? What? There's a need for patience. There's a need for patience on obeying Allah. And there is a need for patience from disobeying Allah. Huh? And I'll finish with this. Imam Zain al-Abidin, Ali ibn Hussein, Ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in, there is a narration that he said, in the day of judgment, the Yawm al-Qiyamah, a man will stand. People are sitting, waiting for their judgment day. A man will stand, أين الصابرون? Where are those who are patients? The people of patience, where are they? Some people say, oh, what is with them? You know, you hear your name being called at that time, you don't know what's going on. Right, good, right, not good, not. Where are the good? Where are the people who have patience? Sabr. Some people, okay, we are. What is it? It is, then that man will tell them, go to Jannah without any hisab. Enter Jannah. So they go. The narration says they went to Jannah. Malaika on the door of Jannah, where do you think you're going? They said, we are as-sabirun, we are the people with patience, and we were told to go to Jannah. Why are you, Malaika tell them, why are you patience, people of patience on what? They say, sabarna ala ta'ati Allah, we were patience on worshipping Allah, wa sabarna an ma'asiyati Allah, and we were patient from disobeying Allah until we died. Huh? Then the narration says then, yes, you are so, enter Jannah. إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. They go like this. And therefore, dear brothers, we can take messages from these ayahs and from these hadith. Huh? Where we can see that success is there. The state of hopelessness has no place in Islam. إِنَّهُ لَا يَيَأَسْ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ لِلْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرُونَ. But then, what is needed is more realizing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our lives. Is more acting that sunnah and living the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not talking about the sunnah only, huh? Living it, practicing it where it hurts. And this is how they went. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad kama sallaita ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ali Sayyidina Ibrahim barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين أعلي مولانا كلمة الحق والدين اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه من أراد بهم غير ذلك فاجعل دائرة السوء عليه اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك ردا جميلا آتي أنفسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اشف اللهم مرضانا وعاف مبتلانا وفك أسرانا وارحم موتانا اغفر اللهم لنا ولآبائنا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حق علينا ولمن على الخير أعاننا ولمن عن الشر أبعدنا ولمن أوصانا بالدعاء صلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى أقم الصلاة